Shaders are amazing. You can do really pretty stuff very easily. So in the long run, it makes your game prettier and saves time making resources. We will cover what a shader is real quick and then teach you how to write what you need for your game. We compress hours worth of information here, so your head might hurt a bit. The important takeaway is the mindset. GPUs are massively parallelized, so we don't think in the scope of a whole picture. We only describe what to do with a single pixel, and this is done for every pixel. So let us start with the examples. We will be using Godot, but it works similarly for other tools. We open it, we add a texture and give it a material, which holds parameters for our shader. And then we add the shader itself. To make a 2D shader, we write shader type canvas item. We type out a fragment function. This means we manipulate the image pixel-wise. For a shader that just reads an image and draws it, we use the texture method. It takes two arguments, the texture to sample and where to sample it. We can use the texture that is assigned with texture. And for the place, well, we have to meditate on this. Remember that this code is run for every pixel. In order to tell them apart, we have their coordinates within the texture. This is called the UV coordinates, and they are always between 0 and 1 in both X and Y dimension. We can reference our UV with the UV keyword. The texture call needs such a coordinate to sample the texture. So let's give it our UV coordinates. We just get the color value we expect and can assign it to the color variable. The shader will draw whatever is assigned to the color variable. And now we can finally see what our changes do. Understanding UVs is the most important thing. And a bit of a headache at first. So let's play around. When we multiply the UV by 2, the texture is sampled more densely, so it will be smaller. The center of the sprite that is at UV 0.5, 0.5 is mapped to 1, 1, the bottom right corner of the texture. We can interchange this 2 with a constant, defined above here, or with a uniform. A uniform is a kind of variable and how we get information from the CPU to the shader. It cannot be manipulated in the shader and always is the same for every pixel. Let's make the 2 into a uniform. We can give it an editor hint, so we get a nice slider. And when we now slide it around, we see that we learned to scale images dynamically. We can also do distortion-like effects, for example by adding a part of the y-coordinate to the x-coordinate. Try to play around for yourself to get a hang of it. If we ever want the graphic to repeat, we can change this in the import settings. We can also manipulate the color. Let us try to make the image grayscale. For this we need to reference the different color channels separately. We can access the components of a vector with R for red, G for green and B for blue, and A for its alpha value. Alpha is the transparency of a pixel. So when we average the R, G and B value, we have a grayscale value. We can write the same value in all the channels, and there it is. I read some people had problems with the built-in modulate, because it cannot add color that is not there. It's only multiplicative. So let us fix that. We can simply multiply the grayscale value with a color to color that image. And for that we add a color uniform with the following line. We can now choose a nice color and the image will change in real time. Many games also need a flash effect. For this we just need one more uniform to decide how flash the graphic is. Get rid of the grayscale. Instead we now interpolate between the flash color and the current color. Luckily this is very easy with the mix function. You say what color is interpolated towards what color and how to mix between those two. Use the original color, the flash color and our interpolation uniform. We can play with the slider and see the magic. The cool thing is each uniform can be animated by an animation player or tween. So maybe add an animation player and change the flash state. It can even animate the color. When you have multiple sprites with the same material, this will change all of them. So we need to make the material local to scene. There's one more trick you need to know before we get into the crazy stuff. Swizzling. With swizzling, you can use the vectors very creatively and access the components in a really cool way. Let's say we want to swap colors around. You can write color RGB equals color GBR and they will swap around. You can even use the same color multiple times, like color RGB equals color RRR to write the same one everywhere. Keep in mind, this is not the same as the grayscale shader. It just switches the red channel to gray and throws away the rest. And we will now do a bit of advanced magic. Fancy distortion effects such as the typical explosion shockwave are made by reading the screen itself. You can access the screen texture by writing screen texture. If you use the UV to sample it, we see the screen in small and flipped. This is because the 0,0 of the sprite is up here and it's mapped to the 0,0 of the screen. We usually want to sample the point directly below the image. So we use the screen UV. This shader now does absolutely nothing. but we can make the same color adjustments and even the same distortions. So let us distort the screen UV, for example, based on our image. If we use different images, we get different results. We can also generate a texture for this purpose. To give it to the shader, add a sampler 2D uniform. They are really helpful texture types that you can generate inside the engine. We can add a noise texture filled with simplex noise, which is basically a cleaner purlin noise. With a little bit of playing around, you can do cool effects with that. But it's a little complicated, so we link the video about that in the description. There are also gradients which are great. For example, to overlay them onto the sprite or to map the sprite's color to the gradient. For this, simply use the brightness and use it to address the gradient, and you get this nice effect. And lastly, curves are amazing. When given to a curve texture, they are translated into a grayscale image. We use them for this black hole, for example. There are other types of shaders as well. Vertex shaders can manipulate the position of objects. They are most impressive in 3D, so we will switch to 3D. We can use the vertex function and now have access to the vertex keyword. With this, we can take this boring plane and add a sinus wave to the Y coordinates. We can make the shift if we want, either by using a uniform or based on the time. To make it time-based, we use the time built-in and add it to the sinus. Now you can see fancy wave effects. You can also sample a texture in the vertex function. The fragment function still exists here. Let's add a part of the UV to the color, just to see a little gradient to visualize UVs once more. But instead of color, we set albedo and alpha. By the way, when you create a spatial material, you can convert it to a shader material. This way you can add your own shader code to existing materials. Shaders can be used for many, many more things. You can control particles with them, because particles are more or less just vertices. We made a whole video about that. You can also apply it to the visuals of a particle and do the wildest stuff with that. We have a whole playlist down in the description with different effects you can do. If this was helpful to you, please give the video a like. If enough people are interested, we can go for a part 2.